Unity is a great concept to be my color advisor. So when we are dealing with consumers on the internet, they can answer questions along with email and so forth. We can also, if we choose later, do online to offline where we would drive traffic to their salons for a sales commission. And Unity is also in the middle of doing their own IPL and has conceptually said they might invest after they have more money. Obayashi is one of my partners. I've worked with him for about 10 years. He basically does all things operations. For now, I'm going to work with the NetWise agency to make my first websites. And when I first started this, I looked at trying to get cloud-based enterprise-level software, but I'm not really ready to afford that. So I will work with NetWise to make the first PC and phone sites, probably using WordPress, Magento, and Marsis. So that would help me cover content, commerce, and personalization. So Wade-san is a TV producer specializing in hair care. The way I would use him is we can make demonstration videos for our website, mail magazines, YouTube videos, for trying to get it open. I'll quickly run through a quick comparison of the three things. eSalon was started by some Silicon Valley guys, doing kind of a price shopping website. They hired colorists. They've gone from 0 to 30 million in 5 years. Their claim to fame is custom hair color, which is a great idea, very complex in terms of software, manufacturing, and so forth. Madison Reed was started, and last year was their first full year of sales. They did 15 million last year, their first year. And this is notable, they raised $32 million in 18 months. Silicon Valley has kind of tempered off a bit, but still, if they get this going, I think we will have all the money we need in the future to grow. The last point I want to make on this is learning and improving on their model. For example, eSalon started with using some plants in the ingredients. Madison Reed went further and got some of the bad ingredients. We're going to go even further with natural and organic. eSalon started with PC. Madison Reed launched a mobile app. We will do things like integrate Line and WeChat as a key part of our marketing. The other part I want to talk about is kind of a lifestyle fashion magazine approach, which is another way to differentiate ourselves. And then I will give you later some examples of strategic partners where I can reduce my cost of acquisition retention to my risk. Skip this. So some of the choices I'm making is they succeeded in the US. We will be the first in Japan. There's nobody in Japan doing this, and as far as I can tell, one little website selling hair color and WeChat, nobody in China. And there's other reasons. The number of manufacturers, the regulatory and so forth things, and we will be first at the end of March in. We're not going to do custom. We found from Madison Reed that personalized is what people can do, and pre-made is a good enough to start. I'm also going to focus with natural in the beginning, but eventually we'll be organic. So it didn't start with the problems, but why do people use hair color? Again, people want to look younger, want to express themselves, it's all within the body that takes care, and they want to take care of themselves. The problems people have are twofold. One is the product. It does damage your hair on the color, and whether it's synthetic or man-made. There's also problems with sensitivity, whether real or imagined. A lot of people don't have any tenants. That's causing a lot of allergy. Distribution is also important. In Japan, people go to the salons and get a wonderful experience, but it is very expensive and can take 2 to 3 hours. Or you can go to the drugstore, and the price is super cheap. The product is pretty crappy, and the brands look the same in the store. So our proposition is we will make salon-quality product for home use. It will be better than drugstores. It will be also more affordable and convenient than the salon. We will be truly more natural. Again, we're going to work on the personalization. On this page, I want to direct you to the advertising and promotion. I talk about a lifestyle brand, beauty, health, well-being, fashion magazine approach, and so on. Women, men, and the whole. It seems like we've been all over the board. We will experiment and research and take certain statements, the acquisition and retention of what I want to make is, you deal with the services like I saw today, you can spend a lot of money getting them to get the U.S. brands that are doing coupons, keyword advertising, affiliate marketing, we'll do all that, it's very careful. So the way I want to differentiate my business model is to partner and establish a distribution basis or customer basis, and in a minute I'll let you attempt it. It's a huge opportunity. I put on there a couple exit options. One includes I might buy it someday, or I've already brought in one partner, number three, which is the OEM. They might buy it someday. There's a lot of potential. It's scalable and flexible. So I want to stay for now internet only. Really protect our brand, our products, and the internet. But as I said, there's a lot of options. So we can add online to offline. We can do on-demand services like calling different categories that have large phones. We can add other product categories, other channels, third-party brand. And I mentioned that I'm watching more models. As earlier today mentioned, Michelle Fan. She's less than 30 years old, probably has 8 million followers on YouTube. We will find our own celebrity scale out. Japan and China. There's some wonderful models that we can learn. Next point is, I can succeed in Japan alone. And in Japan and China. In Japan, almost everybody dies of hair. A woman of age 30 is close to 80%. A man by age is 50%. Young people, so teenagers, 25%. If we succeed with China, I think it could be a grand slam. And I'll show you two things that you'll remember why. I've lived in Japan 25 years, and moved to China actively for the past 5 years, on average about 1 month. I have customers, business partners in China. Alex sells hair brands in 50,000 salons. Aaron, the president of Shanghai Jiao, put the cross-border. Mako is one of my customers. Henga is an online mall. It's an entertainment company. They have very great celebrities in China. Last one is, in the U.S., you can use hair color and shampoo.
That's 60%
shampoo. You can use China. So, I guess that makes sense.
So now again, putting aside money as the issue, who would be interested in using the product? Then show up and I'm the lady here. Can you share with us why?
Well, I guess there's certainly a market out there for home dyeing hair and all that. Like my mom has this problem, like finding the right product for this. But obviously, I have a question regarding to what's the differentiation between these and like the Revlons or the Henna products out there. So I guess that's my question. But certainly, that's something that I would want to try. It's not so pricey.
So to answer your question, brands like Revlon and so forth are generally synthetic and usually very cheap. And if you go into the store, they all look the same. So Revlon, Wella, Clairol, they all look the same. And Henna, as I was trying to address, we avoid the sensitivity issues. And we're going to do internet only. So there's a number of ways that we differentiate.
Thank you. So again, why not? I will invite a lady again. So, can I pass the mic to you?
I prefer Hella for now. So. I'm not sensitive enough.
So I'll invite one more lady. Can you share with us why or why not?
As the lady said, there are a lot of choices in the market.
So I can't see there is any success story. There's a lot of new products in the market already. So I think it's quite difficult to enter into this type of business. I have money for investment, I think it is my own view. Difficult to, not interested in this type of business. Because it is a lot of products available for the consumer to select. So it is a keen condition.
Okay. I'm more optimistic than you. So again, the choice in Japan, you can go to the salon and pay $60 to $100 and it takes 2-3 hours. I'm going to sell a similar quality product, salon quality, but it will be natural and personalized. Or the drugstore and buy Revlon or whatever, I'm going to have a much better product, again, natural and personalized. I think it'll work. And because I ran out of time, I didn't give you two examples of how we will sell in the market. One is, I have a business partner who's got his own cosmetic brand. Half of his business in Japan is sold through pop-up stores. Last year he did almost 1,000 pop-up stores. It'd be like being in the IFC Mall, this place, Harvey Nichols. So we can sell our brand without spending any money up front to collect customers at the best retail locations. I have another partner who, they have 2 million online members. If I do so-so, I might get 10,000 orders first day, as long as he carries me on the website. So, I hope a year from now I can show you that it's working.
So marketing is quite important.
Of course. I mean, every night on Japanese television, they're talking about henna and the problems before it happened. Even my wife's mother is using henna and has problems. I mean, she was wearing a wig and coloring her hair under it. Once we got her to take it off, she had problems. So,
Thanks very much, Steve. Just a couple of points. Firstly, as soon as I saw the presentation, I looked at it before I came today. Straight away, it hit me that you've got a lot of experience, you've got a lot of credentials, and I saw that as an immediate positive. But if I could just make some polite suggestions, I think the way you presented it, I think you need to sort of turn it around a bit. You know a lot about distribution. You've got all these great partners already. You've got a good manufacturer. Product is safe for the person who uses it. I think you've really got to hammer that across. And frankly, as I said earlier today that knowing what your competitors are doing is incredibly important. But I think the way you presented it, there's too much focus on competitors. And I'm thinking, I was looking at eSell. Is it eSell? Is it Madison Reed? So the competitive analysis is critical. But at the end of the day, you just want people to think MK Live. So I think that's really important how you present it. What I want to ask is this, you say it's safe for the person's hair, but is it also environmentally friendly? Because I understand that a lot of the products, hair product, probably not great, wash down the sink and those sorts of things. Is that component in the product as well?
Yes and no. So we will be, with our permanent hair color, at least 90% natural and organic. Still, there are residues from almost anything you're using, whether it's synthetic or natural. But we're not using anything which we think is harmful.
Right, thanks. And the other question I've got is that I think a lot of the audience thought about, okay, if you're an existing user, and will you go from what you've got today and move to this product? The other question is, what about how do you get to those people who don't use a hair color, the first time users? Because I think that could be a big opportunity. So have you thought about two aspects? How do you get existing users onto your product? And how do you get new users onto your product? How are you going to attack those two particular points?
Okay. So, I ran out of time, but it was in the slide. So, with the new users, we are going to try young men. Right now, young men is probably one of the fastest growing segments. So, if you have cosmetics, anti-aging, face masks, men, Korean cosmetics are really the hot things at the moment. With young men, 25% penetration. If I can pick up the 30%, I can retire. Okay? So that's the thing. And that's like doing PR in the right magazines for young men, shopping for us. As far as converting people, we're going to focus more on the low and middle end. So converting drugstore users first with a much better product at a decent price. We don't want to threaten salon brands in the beginning.
Thank you for your presentation, Steve. I think just first off, just some comments about your presentation. I think it, similar to what Sebastian says, I just saw that you had a lot of data on there. So I can tell you're very analytical, you want to be very thorough. But just kind of make sure that you just kind of get to the point in terms of like when you slide is there's too much information on there, and as you're trying to process it, as the audience is trying to process it, and you're flipping through the slides, it's hard because you're still kind of thinking about the last slide, and you're already talking about the next one. So I think fewer slides, if you want to get the investor interested, but you want to rehearse timing, you ran out of time on your presentation, so you want to make sure you rehearse it and sort of have a proper time management in it. And I think also in terms of your presentation, be more punchy, telling the story, don't have it sort of monotone, but really kind of get more energized in it, and I think that would sort of really sort of keep the interest there. So those are just some comments there, and then also you had like your first slide is like two slides trying to put onto one page, and there's too much information, so just kind of keep it a bit shorter and more concise. Okay, so the question I have is a very simple one. Is in one sentence describe what your business is.
We are going to market and sell hair color, hair care, and skin care using phone and PC and deliver to the home using subscription billing.
So that would be sort of good as your headline is to just sort of explain that in the beginning. This is what you're doing. So. So that way, in that frame of mind, the audience can sort of see what your business is. But yeah, so what Sebastian was saying in terms of like the focus on competitors, that's important. But if there's an emphasis on it, it gets a bit sort of muddled in terms of like what is it that you're doing. And then the other question I had is what's the price point of what you're selling?
So the hair color, which would be the star product, sell for $5. Again, that compares with $60 to $100 if you go to the salon, $5 to $29.
And then the people that go to a salon, so I don't dye my hair, but I know that women, when they go to a salon, is because they don't want to have to deal with the pain points of doing it at home, drying their hair, and putting all that stuff in their hair, and standing in front of the mirror, and doing all that. They would rather just pay a little more money and have someone do it for them at the salon. So the pain point, I think, is maybe the hassle for the trouble of having to do it themselves. So if I take that analogy and think about, well, if I'm going to color my hair, and it's messy, and it gets all over the floor, or it stains my clothes, or whatever it is that needs to be done, why don't I just go to a hair salon and do that? What is the pain point that you're trying to solve here?
Our product, by the way, will not be that painful in terms of how to apply it to the best clothes. But the pains are for the salon buyer, it is much cheaper and you save a lot of time. Also, compared to the salon buyer, the stylist often will help you with color matching. They don't really put you much more than that. We will use the internet more. With the drugstore, we have a vastly superior product, salon quality. And in both cases, it will be more natural. So I would say lower price point, affordable, better product. In both cases, natural and more information.
So if you're talking about drugstore, then what you're really referring to is sort of your distribution points and for yeah. So from a consumer product standpoint, you're only as successful as the number of distribution points you have. So if you take, for example, like a Watson's or a Manning's or whatever the equivalent is in Japan, you want to be with that chain retailer that has those distribution points across the city or across the country. But then you also have to focus on sort of pinpointing, doing the right distribution deals, whether you're trying to do an exclusive one with one distributor or doing several, multiple distributors across different regions. And that becomes a very important point. So with the team of the people that you had mentioned there, do you have someone on your team that understands how to do those types of distribution deals across drug stores?
Yes. So sorry if it wasn't clear, but we're going to do internet only. So I can always go to retail, and that's what I've been doing for 27 years. We're going to do internet only.
So you're purely just an e-commerce platform. So how would you drive traffic to your site? Okay.
So again, two examples I gave you. It's doing the pop-up stores. I pop-up stores 2 to 3 to 4 weeks. I don't spend any money on the revenue share. So they have trained demonstrators to fulfill. So they'll have a table, sales girls. We can track people and have them. And then the other one I mentioned was Slender Sales, that has the 2 million online members. They do email campaigns based on past experience. They get 5 to 10,000 orders to one email. If that happens, happens day one.
Okay, so then the focus is really more on sort of coming up with these campaigns on a regular basis to sort of drive that traffic.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve, for the presentation. I know you flew in from Japan, so it's tiring. So thank you very much again for buying in. A few comments and also some questions. Yeah, I'm more interested in your initial, but like Eric and Sebastian have said, I've spotted a few key points that investors are really interested in. Number one is you've got a first investor already, which is number three, and they have 6,000 POSs in Japan. Now, as a startup or as a company, would you be leveraging on that, or are you just sticking into them and say, yeah, don't be the internet guy, we don't leverage on that 6,000 POSs in Japan?
In the beginning, I'm relying on that company for their expertise, their research and development, their formulation, their manufacturing, their knowledge of salon customers. Okay? They are worried that their salons or the distributors are going to be unhappy that they are supporting me on the internet. Okay? So I always have the option in the future to say, internet plus retail, plus a shop, we'll go to salons, and I may do that long term. The short run, I want to test them.
Okay, just a comment from here. I would strongly suggest that you talk to the three first, because I don't know the structure of that deal behind, but as an investor, I would say that they will be pretty much supportive of you, and how they leverage on their current business with what you have around here, that is pretty much a key stepping stone for business going along. And like I said to a lot of businesses, I know that your eventual goal is going to grow. But you can first go through Italy, go through Russia, go to India first, and then have to grow. So in the meantime, these 6,000 POSs may not be as conflicting as they think they would think. It may be complementary to their existing salons or their existing products as well. So I would definitely look into that and see how we can leverage on that, because as an investor, a lot of investors will not be interested in the product, but will be more interested in actually you've got 6,000 POSs in Japan. Now, how you leverage that is one key point in terms of how you motivate the next investor.
With them, one of the things we're going to do is 95% of their business is Japan, so I'm going to try and help them on a B2B basis using the internet and other places. I mentioned the Unix hair salons. I am going to be testing the salon market with a customer, the one who asked me to find your haircut. My guess is, just as it's working, that there's 2 or 3 major hair distributors in Japan. potentially have $300,000 to $500,000. Where I mentioned how it's going to be China. There's a number of Chinese care players. So yes, we will be doing that.
So one of the major things I'm looking at is the actual price point there is. You're not the top, you're not the lowest. You're sort of like right in the middle of the $500,000. So the fact is, putting it into some of the POSs actually gets you a lot more coverage and also the branding itself. How do you use that? How do you leverage the fact? How do you use these heads of wands? And also, if you're looking for overseas investors, your expertise and your strength in Japan actually gives you an edge.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Desmond. I think, you know, Desmond's points are really critical because, of course, Derek's as well. You know, KPMG actually did a survey of a large number of Chinese consumers late last year, around 10,000, I think. And one of the key things that came out of it was they were quite surprised on how, when the Chinese consumers, they'll do their research. And then they'll figure out, okay, well, I found this product, now I'm going to find the best price. And a lot of the case was they do their research and then they take a whole day and buy it, or they do their research and then go and buy it online. I think with the point of sale stuff and the experience that you're trying to, the new experience you're trying to give, the fact that it's safer for you, I think you've got a real opportunity to build some product awareness, build this experience, and leverage that in terms of into the Chinese market when it's the right time. Because as we all know, I think there's quite a lot of respect in the Chinese consumers for the quality of the Japanese product. And the packaging on the Japanese product, it is very helpful as well. So I think, you know, I think if you can get that right with your distribution, you know, you could really, you know, jump ahead in terms of your ability to launch your product maybe through the internet into China. So I think I agree with Desmond, you really got to try and get that right with your distribution networks and your guys manufacturing for you.
Thank you. Can we now invite the master for presentation? At the same time, we would love to invite Mr. Derek Quick for a 1 minute investor section. Thank you.
I've been doing investing in early stage startup technology companies since 99, so I have maybe 18 years of experience doing this, and the technology companies back in the late 90s, early 2000 were offering products and services that are probably what a lot of young people here think was just a given, which were free email and web portals. And that was about as exciting as the internet was back then. And today, of course, it's much more advanced. There's a lot more things going on. It's much more interesting. And that kind of leads me to fundraising, which is what Pitch Perfect sounds like it is, but it's more than just fundraising. Pitch Perfect is really about communicating your idea to an audience, whether it's to you guys this way, whether it's to these guys that way, or maybe to the people that way. But basically, it's about communicating the idea and convincing people that you have something that is interesting, it's engaging, and it's to you. And from that standpoint, for fundraising or pitching, I think that if you guys out there have a startup company, you should always be pitching your company. And it doesn't mean you're always out there fundraising. It could mean you're pitching, you're advertising your company, you're telling people how great your business is, you're putting people on newsletters, you're getting the word out there, you're getting the brand recognition, and you're doing that very, very early on so that you can cut through all of that introductory stuff, all that introductory nonsense that you have to do when you do a pitch, because people already are aware of your brand, they know the company, they know what you're doing, right? So I always tell people, like, if you're going to raise money and you plan to do it end of this year, let's say, I don't know, let's say October, November, then you want to start pitching today. You want to start talking to people today, and you want to create the idea that the, you know, the
what the opportunity that you're presenting to them is very special. It's by invitation, not everybody can invest. And you want to create that sense of urgency that this is a really awesome opportunity, and you better get in now, or it's going to be too expensive for you to get in later, right? So pitching is really an art, it's a skill, and you have to practice telling the story to the to investors, to your audience, over and over and over again, until it gets to a point where you're not reading slides off of a presentation anymore, you're telling the story. Everybody wants to hear a story, nobody wants to hear a presentation. Trust me, I've done this a lot, and I've heard it many, many times, and after you hear so many presentations, just within like the first few minutes, you can tell whether or not it's going to be interesting or if it's going to be engaging. It's never too early to be pitching your company. It's never too early to be raising your money. It's always, you know, cut through all the stuff that you can get to between now and the end of the year. That way, when you call up the investor and say, "Hey, I have my company. I've been talking for the past 6 months. Okay, now we're fundraising," and then that audience already has heard about your company, and you can cut through all of the introductions and you can get right to business. So that will really speed up the decision-making process for an investor if they know about your company earlier. So I'd just like to leave you with one slogan that I like to always remind myself of is don't wait. The time will never be just right.
Okay, does this work? Yeah, I usually tend to speak very loud, so let me know if it's okay or if I should put it somewhere else. Hello everybody, thank you very much for coming. I'm Jan, and this is Steve, and we are from Hulala. Today we are gonna talk about, I would like to start with the mission we have at Hulala, because our mission is actually to change the way how people perceive and consume Asian fashion. Yeah, we want to make it more accessible. And I'd like to start with what is actually modern Chinese style, modern Chinese fashion. What is it? Because we don't know yet. And even people from woke don't know it. So that's actually what we want to change with Voila. We believe that we are still at the beginning of the revolution, or the revolution is gonna start, and we want to be there. We want to be the trigger for that. And to be the trigger, we actually need to support those independent fashion designers at the beginning, and we want to help them to bring their unique products to the worldwide audience in the end of the day. Yeah, and that's why we call ourselves an international launchpad for the next wave of Asian fashion designers. Yeah, and so why don't people actually know about the modern Asian fashion or Chinese fashion? That's simple, because as I mentioned, it doesn't exist yet, really, in a sense that you can actually imagine something. When I say modern Chinese fashion, you don't really know, or we don't know, and people even from Vogue, as we mentioned, because the editor in chief, she visited China, and she said, "I see many, many beautiful things, but I didn't see anything that I can really call the modern Chinese stuff." Yeah, and this happened in Japan, for example, before that they didn't have anything like that, but then it basically started occurring, and it started with those independent fashion designers. And that's why we want to support those, and we want to start with China, because we believe that China is on the verge of discovering the modern Chinese style. Yeah. And so we are cross-border e-commerce platform, and to help those independent Chinese designers or Asian designers to actually get to the worldwide audience. Then there is definitely the problem of size, right? So you can imagine, I have been living in China for 1 year and a half, let's say, and every time I go shopping, I have a problem with size, because it's different, right? We are all different, and the same holds for Asian people shopping outside of China or outside of Asia, because that makes sense, yeah? So how are we gonna solve this problem? At the first stage, we only want to focus on Asian brands, those Asian independent fashion designers, and sell them to Asian customers. Yeah, because I believe, or we believe, that maybe in the future this problem of size will be solved by technology or by the demand for the more customized clothing, for example, like 3D printing and all these things we hear all about. But at this point, it's as simple as that. We're only going to focus on Asian brands and Asian customers. Yeah. Then also, there's too many products, right? And if you look around, every single one of you wears a different type of clothing, right? So just imagine if you go to Taobao, for example, in China, we all see the same products, right? And it's very hard to navigate, to filter within this ocean of products. So we want to offer the personalized shopping experience. And how are we going to do it? We actually collect a lot of data, and we're going to talk about it a little bit more during the presentation. And last but not least, these brands, these independent Chinese or Asian designers, they lack resources and expertise to enter the international markets or the global markets, right? So thanks to our team and our partnerships and in-house expertise, we can actually help them with logistics solutions, we can help them with operations, with localization, with customer service, and stuff like that. So that's something we help with as well. How it works, I actually talked about data collection, so Steve can show you how it works in the app. But so we implemented very simple Tinder-like function, swiping, right? So if you go to the app, you can very easily swipe what you like and don't like. And we get this data from you, we can analyze it, and we only give you products that you actually are willing to buy or where the probability is much higher that you will actually proceed to the checkout, let's say. Yeah? And another value added of this data is that we actually analyze this data and provide them with we provide the brands with this data as well, because then we can say, okay guys, this is not really selling, people don't really like it, so maybe you should change it, and you will do much better on our platform or in general. Or we can actually help them to develop a different collection, yeah? So that's it. And this swiping function is actually pretty popular, because you can see that last month, 10,000 users on our platform swiped 175,000 products. Yeah, so it really works. And real quick, the plan. So I said, first, it's China, because we believe that it's on the verge of discovering the modern Chinese style. Then it's Asia, especially Southeast Asia, because we have expertise, we have our strategic officer actually has some knowledge of this market. And then it's global, let's say maybe Asians globally, we don't know yet really, but we wanna focus first on Asia, because Asian independent fashion designers, right? And this is just some data from China, for example. We can see that the middle class is really booming, everybody knows about it, it's anything new. And then Southeast Asia, the same. You can see the growth rate, the projected growth rate of e-commerce itself is really, really high. Yeah. And now I'm gonna hand over to Steve to talk about team and other stuff.
Okay. So thanks, Jan. Basically, I'll just quickly introduce our team. So we have myself. I have experience in the app marketing business in China for the last 4 years. And Lucas previously worked for a top Czech design company, bringing their products into Chinese market. And we both speak fluent Mandarin, so this is good for China. And then we have Jerry, who's our CSO. He has over 10 years of entrepreneurial experience, and he has his own app marketing platform, which is focusing on marketing to global markets, especially Southeast Asia and Japan. And then we have Kit, who's our insight into the independent fashion designers in China. She has her own independent fashion brand, and she also used to work for Zhoushiwa, which is a popular e-commerce platform in China. And then we have Yan. He previously worked for Rocket Internet, who have several projects in Southeast Asia. They're very successful there. So he has a great network in Southeast Asia. And then the bottom is our developer team and our customer service team. So what do we have the others doing apart from our awesome team? We have a verified supplier network. So we have almost 100 independent fashion brands on our platform right now. We focus purely on Asian independent fashion design, so no more size problems for Asian customers. Even distribution of traffic, so like the Tinder swiping page, you know, this is evenly distributed, the products are randomly shown, and we learn from the data so we can show products to users, maybe show users products that they like. And strong global marketing capabilities through our partners and our international team. So currently we registered our company last July in Shanghai, and then we tested at the end of the year in Hong Kong and China, and we launched in the 14th of January in China, and within the first 1.5 months, we had 10,000 users, and we expect to have 20,000 users at the end of this month, which is growing super fast. We expect next month to be 50,000 users, and the best thing about our users is we managed to get down to 12 RMB acquisition costs, which is super low, below $2. And these users are high quality users as well. So after 1 day, around 25% come back, and this is increasing over time. And after 1 week, we have seen users of over 30% coming back. And after 2 weeks, sometimes also 30%, 25 to 30%. Our revenue so far, we have 1.8% of active users place order daily. And each order is quite high with 220 RMB, which is above average in China. And this week we had around 2,000 RMB per day of revenue from quite a small amount of users, so this is quite high. So, our financials, we have $30,000 a month burn rate, and we're currently raising pre-Series A. Our business model is very simple, it's commission-based. We hope to push it up to 30% average commission across all sales. And in the future, we will build in advertising and value-added services for the brand, like localization, translation, photography, etc. And also through international fulfillment, as we expect to be a global platform. And so lastly, Yan said, modern Chinese fashion style doesn't exist yet. It doesn't exist. So we hope the next time that Anna Wintour arrives in China, she will say, ooh la la. And this is the modern Chinese fashion, guys. So thank you for your time, guys. If you have any questions, feel free to ask away. And you can download the app.
Cool, thank you. So, putting money aside, okay? Who would be interested in cooperation or to use their service? I can listen to them. Oh, yeah, I saw the hands. Any more hands? Okay, I'll pass the mic.
Hello. Maximus. Hello. I like your idea. I want to know, you know, customers are distributed around globally or at least in China, as your idea present, and as well those designers in China distributed evenly, I say. Would you manage the logistics for them?
In the first step, right now, our brands are shipping themselves. So it's a platform, they put their products online. If we have sales, they ship it themselves. The next step is we've already begun to partner with an international logistics company. And so when we move into Southeast Asia, they will ship to our supplier, our logistics warehouse in China, and then they will ship it directly to the customer from China. So for our brand, it's just as simple as sending to a Chinese customer to send it to a Southeast Asian customer.
How do you judge, you set the commission price at 30%, how do you judge it? Or how do you price it at this level?
Actually, in the beginning, we started at 0%. So we had no commission to get brands on board. And we began to push it up to around 15%. And what we've seen is competitors in Southeast Asian market, we spoke to like Lazada, Zalora, they say they if they provide the logistics service for their brand, they make up to 50% commission. Right? So 50% is ridiculously high. And if they're not providing logistics service, they provide it at 30%. So the way we can push it up is to start off with Chinese brands. Chinese brands is a very competitive market, so the commission has to be lower, maybe like 15%, 20%. But when you go into Southeast Asia, these independent brands are willing to pay much more, especially to enter into Chinese market. So you can charge them 30%, 40%. So when I say 30%, this is an average. So once we provide the logistics service, we hope to actually make a much higher commission based on this.
Are the designers that collaborating with you currently happy with that? Just out of curious, I'm not judging that level.
I mean, so far they're quite happy. We have never had a single complaint about the commission so far. So, I think it's going quite well.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, one more?
So there's a swiping function of like or dislike, right? Then you can determine
which style is currently in trend. But do you correlate that data with the profile of the user? And if so, how do you do it? And how are you going to focus in delivering what's trend for this user?
Okay, so at the moment, let's say our average user that swipes is swiping around 45 to 60 products a day. Right? So if you imagine that each product has like 10 keywords, you know, or the color, the size, everything, then we have a lot of data, because you have like the 58 times however many data points you have in each product. So we gather a lot of data super fast. People are swiping a lot of products, 175,000 products last month. And in providing the correct products to specific customer, we segment them. And actually, at the moment, we're not segmenting them yet. This is a feature that we're building in right now. But in the future, we'll begin to segment them and show them specific content based on what they swipe. So it will be based on, let's say you like pink products, right? I'm not saying you like pink products. Yeah. Maybe you like pink, right? So when you go onto our platform, you'll be swiping more pink products, right? So then we will begin to show you in all the other pages, in the product pages, we will show pink results closer to the top. It's just all about our search algorithms taking your data into account when we show you product, so that you're not wasting time looking through like thousands of blue products when you want to see the pink ones, you know, like, a disaster. Right?
Thank you. I also would love to hear some no's. So who will hesitate to use their product? Yeah? Okay.
Hi, no, I'm not totally against it. Previously, I was solder and solver as well. So, hi, Jen. Hello. Anyway, so I mean, like, coming from more so from a designer point of view, like, it's definitely, it should be a platform that, like, they would just always go onto a platform that serves a marketing purpose for them, right? Just like what solder and solver. How would you guys, like, you know, actually pitch to these designers and tell them that you can do marketing better than what Rocket did? That's just my period.
In the beginning, it was tough, right? Because we had no users, and you have this like chicken and egg problem, right? You have like you go to the brand and say, hey, can you sign up? And they're like, how many users do you have? And say, 200. No, not so enough. And then you have the users. You have to have brands on there to get them to go on your platform, right? So there's this big problem. In the beginning, we spent a lot of time giving them the free commissions, getting them on. In China, actually, it's been very fast. Like everyone is like interested to get on as many platforms as possible. Because they want like the exposure. They don't care about the sales. They just want exposure, so they just join every platform, right? So once we had like 10 brands, it got much simpler. And because these brands began to get sales, like we had one brand last month that had like 4,000 revenue sales just for one small brand, which is quite a lot for these very small brands. And now we're beginning to see brands just coming to us. We're not going to pitch to them. They're saying, hey guys, can I join? So we see that as we grow, and this is one main reason for doing China first, is to get that network of brands on our platform that trust us before we start moving into like Southeast Asian markets. Because we want people in China to know what Ulala is. We want them to say to their friends, hey, you should get on there, because I'm making like 10,000 RMB a month and I'm spending nothing on marketing. So we believe that the quality of our product and the fact that our product works and the sales will come in will attract more people. But we also have a team of people finding brands. So we do both sides.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I've got two questions, actually. Can we talk about your first investor?
Yes, our first investor is...
No, I'm just asking. Is that confidential or...?
No, it's not confidential.
Okay.
Not confidential.
The question is, how did you sell them? How did you sell your idea, pitched your ideas to them, and they invested it? That's number one. Number two is, did you do any research in terms of your customer retention? Platforms like these, they're down a dozen. The fact is, you have people coming back to you, retain coming back to you as a very high loyalty. That's something I'm very interested in. Most of the brands will be very interested. Did you do any research in terms of why these particular customers are coming back again and again?
Okay, so the first question, our first investor is actually my previous boss. And I wouldn't necessarily class him as investor so much as he's a co-founder. So we pitched to him, me and my business partner Lucas, who's sadly not here today. But we pitched to him and we just wanted some feedback. We're so like Derek said, we were just pitching to as many people as possible, getting feedback. And at the end of our pitch, he just said, do you want some money? And we're like, And so he joined us. We still work in the office, so he's part of the team. So we don't really see it as an investment. We see it sort of, he's one of the co-founders, and he's putting the money in. And he's still part of the team, and he provides a lot of service for us with the ad marketing. He's one of the reasons we can push the price down so low to the 12 RMB. And with regards to retention, we have worked really hard on our retention. This is something that required a lot of research and analytics. That's what the guys come back from with analytics. We basically focus, anytime we have a problem with our app, we always analyze it and work out exactly what it is. And so the retention, one of the things that you saw when you're swiping is you got a home bar in there, right? You got the money. This is to increase our retention. So when people are swiping every day, the reason we managed to increase the swiping so much is because if you come back every day, you can get a voucher. And that voucher expires after a week, so most of the people will never spend it. But this brings people back. And so this increased our swiping like 30%. And we also realized that when we're talking about people that are swiping, if we compare the two retentions, let's say the people that open the app and then the next day they basically never come back, right? So that the people that are swiping is super high. Sometimes we saw that like 40% retention. For not just for 1 week, it's like 40% week one, 40% week two, 40% week three. So we saw this thing that is really working and bringing people back, and is really successful, and we just built upon it. We made it, or you can get home miles in there, you can get everything in there. If you come back every day, you get more. And so we really focused on all these things that are working well in the app, and bringing people in back.
I got Grant's wife just as top layer.
Thank you for your presentation. You were at Rocket. Rocket's not an investor or involved?
No, they're not.
Okay. And then you mentioned your user base. You plan to have 20,000 users by the end of March, right? And your conversion rate is like 25% of people who come back. Well, what's the conversion rate to revenue?
So, of our daily active users that open the app, 1.8% of them place orders every month. And we have around 5% of daily active users that come into the app every day.
And then what kind of campaigns or methods are you going to use to sort of push that number up?
To push the retention or to push the
20%?
I mean, one of the things is the home bar that we already implemented, which is like the lucky money and the swiping pleasure. Because if they have vouchers, they're more likely to spend.
Right.
Other things that we're doing, we have a brand coupon feature. So with our brands, they can share on their like Facebook, their Weibo, whatever, mm-hmm. and we offer discount on their products. So this is a way of us bringing people back and increasing the conversion rates, because our brands will help us to market, so the brand affiliate marketing through our brand. These are the things we're pushing right now, and the other things we're pushing are we're working with some KOLs in China, which is going quite well, because the KOLs are bringing in much higher quality users.
And then specific to the China market, how does an application like WeChat play into your marketing and your promotion?
WeChat has played quite a lot. I mean, not into our marketing. I would say our marketing, WeChat is on a downward curve for marketing. WeChat is almost, it's getting really hard to do WeChat. No one is opening things on WeChat because there's too much data in there. I don't open anything on WeChat rather too much. So the way that WeChat helped us is the WeChat login. The WeChat login made everything go skyrocketing, because if people come in and they don't have profile pictures, because we just had a phone number login, no one is coming back. The people look at the content, it's all these people with the default profile pictures and the username is their phone number. And like, who wants to look at that? Like, you're looking at a couple of digits, right? You want to know their name, you want to see their profile picture, you want to see what they're all about. So this really improved our app overall, is bringing in all their data and their profile picture, their name. This made because it personalized our whole app, and it changed everything when we added the WeChat login.
Your use of proceeds, what would you spend in, what milestones would that take you to forward? Because you're pre-Series A, so the round that you're raising now, what would you achieve with that?
We expect we're raising 1.4 million, and we expect we can get close to 600,000 to 700,000 users with that. And I think this will validate our product in China. And once we can validate in China, on the side, we will be doing some testing in Southeast Asia at the same time to validate the model in Southeast Asia and learn about how Southeast Asians are using our app. Because the way that Southeast Asians are shopping is very different to the way that Chinese people are shopping. And so we need to start learning. So this money will also be used to begin learning about Southeast Asia do a test, maybe get like 10,000-20,000 users in Southeast Asia to get start to know how they use the app, and so we can adapt it for them. Because this is key before we start spending a lot of money just going straight to Southeast Asia.
Okay, and then the 1.4, I think you said your burn is like 30K a month. How much of that would be used towards your monthly?
The 1.4, you mean as opposed for our like cost?
Yeah.
We expect around, I mean, we expect our cost to go up to about 60 to 70,000 a month. So we this is around 1 year of time. We expect this to give us about 1 year of time, with most of the money going towards marketing.
Okay. And then my last question is what is the competitive landscape look like?
Okay, so competitive landscape, we see, I mean, you know e-commerce, right? There's a lot of e-commerce guys, but we see that no one has really found this problem yet of the Asian size fit. And we think it's crazy, you know, like, people are saying we are doing like global brands, you know, but like global brands don't fit Asia. It's like, what are you doing? Why are you doing that? So we see there's a lot of competitors in Southeast Asia, like Lazada, Zalora. And then in China, there's a lot of competitors that are trying to do foreign brands. And no one seems to be really focusing on just Asian people with Asian brands, which we believe is a really big problem right now. And we've spoken to people like Calvin Klein, and they said, and other people that are in big fashion companies, and they say they have to completely redesign every range for the market. They have to resize everything. But no one seems to be doing it online yet. No one seems to have seen this problem. And some of the consultants we spoke to that are consulting for like Calvin Klein, Tommy Hilfiger, and this sort of stuff. And they're saying that none of these brands want to do it. They just say, oh, we don't need to do that. We just sell it. And our products, people buy them anyway. And he says that the ones that are successful, like Calvin Klein, are the ones that are changing their products to fit the markets that they're going into.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much, guys. Just want to say that I think you articulated the pitch very well. And in addition to that, you really back it up with the necessary research. So I commend you on that. I think a lot of the questions I had have been covered, but I just want to, perhaps it's a bit early yet to think about this, but how committed are you to this idea about modern Chinese style and to Asian brands? And what I mean by that is, do you think you'll get to a stage where you also get involved in some offline activity? So, for example, you know, are there designer associations in China? You know, are you going to support those associations? If there's a designer association event and I turned up to it, will I see your logo? I think if you want to, you know, are you going to try to get that loyalty from the designers and your suppliers to make them feel that you're supporting and building their community, so you help them build an identity?
We already run our own offline event, actually. Every 2 weeks we have an event in Shenzhen, so you guys are welcome to come, just across the border. And we invite independent designers, we invite someone to talk. So like last week we invited someone from Zhongxiuwa, like one of the directors, to come and express like how they find their brand, really to teach. Because we want to really teach our brands how to do international marketing, how can they improve their brand. So we run every 2 weeks, we invite a speaker, one or two speakers, to basically teach our brands about the fashion industry and how they can improve their service and their design. So this is something we're doing, and of course in the future we actually partnered with a local shop in Shenzhen, which is like a big space. So we get space for free. I mean, basically we spend absolutely nothing on it, and it's incredible. And we get like 100 to 200 people coming every 2 weeks.
I think that's brilliant.
No pressure.
Do you think you'll be eventually forced into a situation where, and I don't mean this as a negative, where you'll, you know, with your pricing, will you have to sort of adjust your site where, depending on how much people want to spend, because, you know, you're in the swipe, so you're swiping along in 150 RMB, 200 RMB, then 5,000 RMB, is that going to, I guess you'll let the data drive that, or in terms of purchasing, or how, what sort of suppliers you'll have, will decide that? How's that going to work? And eventually, I think, will you start to splitting your products based on cost, premium products versus not so much premium products?
This is something quite a few users have asked us. They said in the Tinder page, like the swiping page, how can I filter? Can I just see t-shirts? Can I just see products that are this price range? At the moment, we try to all of our products are sort of within like the 200 to 800 RMB range. There's like about 80% of them are. There's some products that are 2,000 RMB. But we try to really control the price because we think that the best thing actually about Asian fashion in general, and especially Chinese, is the price point is so low. Because these are designers that are in like Guangdong province, they can just go straight to the factory and like negotiate with the guy and say, no, I want that 100 RMB cheaper. You know, they can just get it cheap. Whereas if you're like in Shanghai, you look at the Shanghai independent fashion, it's much higher. It's like, what, 2,000 RMB, 3,000 RMB. So what we've tried to do is focus on independent fashion, which is high quality, but with those brands that have good relationships with their suppliers, and they're not trying to say, I'm selling a t-shirt for 3,000 RMB. So we really try to only have brands that are affordable. So this is how we're tackling that at the moment. In the future, we will probably add some features for the Tinder page too. I keep calling it the Tinder page, but to change the
filter. So you actually are saying that you've got a quality product side. So are you saying, have you rejected any suppliers? Have you thought, let's take an example, Uniqlo. To me, they're producing a quality product, an innovative product, technologically advanced product.